talked about Eric Reid, of course, on Monday. Actually, it was a Sunday after the game. Some media asked Eric Reid his whole back and forth with Malcolm Jenkins. I can't wait to get y'all thoughts on this.
All right, folks, back to that Roland Unfiltered video in just one moment.
I want to thank one of our newest supporters. I'm going to talk to you about right now. If you're looking for a hot new investment opportunity, I have two things I want you to think about: legal marijuana and crowdfunding. Now, you just let that sink in for a second. Our friends at Transatlantic Real Estate have created a unique opportunity for everyday investors like you to get in the game for as little as $300. Typically, it takes millions or billions to invest in the legal marijuana industry. Some folks, we're going to leave that alone. But and it can be pretty risky trying to establish market share. However, Transatlantic Real Estate is taking a different approach. They buy the land that supports marijuana grow operations and lease it to licensed high-paying tenants. Now, imagine being a landlord to licensed marijuana farm with the prospect of further legalization and changing public perceptions about marijuana. Some investors could end up making serious money over the next few years in this multi-billion dollar industry. The best part is they're using crowdfunding, so you can get in now before they take the company public. If you want more information, go to marijuanastock.org. That's marijuanastock.org. Now back to your Roland Martin Unfiltered video. And so this was the interview that took place after the game, where Eric Reid explained a week after his fight with Malcolm Jenkins why he called Malcolm Jenkins of the Philadelphia Eagles a sellout. Listen.
I can get some more clarity to why I believe he's a sellout if y'all got a minute to hear a story.
Sure.
Y'all remember that that players owners meeting in New York City? So we were brought in under the premise that the NFL wanted to use their resources to help the black community. We established within the first 5 minutes of that meeting that we weren't there to negotiate and into the process. After about an hour and a half of talking, Bob McNair says, I think the elephant in the room is this protesting. Terry Pegula follows up with, yeah, I've already lost two sponsors for my hockey team. We need to put a Band-Aid on this, and we need a black figurehead to do it. What's the Eagles owner's name? Lurie. Lurie says, we can do more for the black community than you can ever imagine with our resources. Bob McNair then says, yeah, just make sure you tell your comrades to stop that protesting business. So we leave that meeting. We reestablish internally, the people that are involved with the Players Coalition, that we weren't negotiating and into the protest. The NFL said they wanted to use its resources to help the black community, so I was fine with giving my opinion on how they could do that. That changed the last week of November when Malcolm called me on the phone and asked if the NFL made a donation to the Players Coalition, would that be enough for me to stop protesting? He said that they were willing to do $5 million. And I told him, no, we've already established for the two times prior to this that we weren't negotiating and into the process. He then asked me, well, how much would it take? So I ended that conversation. I reported back to the other players what he said to me. And at that point, we removed ourselves from the Player Coalition. That weekend, Malcolm stopped protesting. He said that it was time for everybody to stop protesting. He didn't protest the rest of the year. The following May, the NFL and the Players Coalition finalized and announced their deal. And within 24 hours of that, the NFL changed the policy on the national anthem, requiring everybody to stand. So those series of events are not a coincidence. The NFL used him to change the anthem policy to force it into the protest to satisfy its sponsors, like Terry Pegula mentioned, and probably also to satisfy the President of the United States.
Eton, he said a lot. Laid that thing out.
Yeah. He said a lot.
He sold out.
And you have to understand the passion that he has and what he feels about what he was doing. You know, it's not something that he looked at as a as an opportunity to further, you know, this is the thing. I interviewed different people from the Players Coalition. I interviewed Anquan Boldin. I have a lot of respect for him. You know, he talked about why he got into activism in the first place.
Right.
He talked about seeing his cousin being killed by the police and hearing it and talking to him on the phone why his cousin's being killed.
Mm.
Interviewed Eric Reid, and he's talking about why he's passionate. So they both have passions and are pure as far as to why they're doing this. I think they have different views of how to handle the NFL wanting to insert themselves and react to the protests.
Which, let me say this right now, is no different
right.
than when SNCC differed with MLK, who differed with the NAACP, who differed from CORE, who differed from others. What they did was they got in a room, they sorted those issues out and said, how then do we move forward?
Right.
The thing that was interesting here, Spencer, was when Eric began to break down how the NFL would say, oh, no. In order for this to happen, we're going to limit how much each player gives. He's like, wait a minute, hold up. How are you going to limit me to $5,000 if I want to give $25,000? So it was as if the NFL was like, no. If you want this money, then all these different strings and restrictions where they, in essence, were determining.
It's kind of the puppeteer type of thing, still in control. And, you know, these brothers still stepped up to the plate and said, hey, we're going to do our thing, and we want some real freedom. We're not just kind of being the marionette.
And I think, Teresa, when you listen to Eric Reid lay this out, and we have not heard Malcolm Jenkins come out to dispute any of what Eric Reid said. He hasn't said, okay, let me correct the record. That's an issue, because when you listen to Eric talk about how they were going to limit this and limit this and this, and we're going to take it from breast cancer and shift it over here, basically, they were just playing a little shell game, three-card money.
So in Malcolm Jenkins' defense, he picked and chose a battle he believed at the time he could win. And at that time, it was the financial gain. And I think it's actually a lesson to all of the players, you know, if the NFL is going to limit the amount that you can spend to donations, what personal wealth have you been saving or investing where when they start pulling those strings, they are no longer tied to that and they can just have
No. See, this case here, Eton, go ahead.
But it was fool's gold. And what they were trying to do, they were going to twist it and use the media to say, see, they wanted us to take away from breast cancer awareness. I guarantee you that's what they would have done. They would have showed, like, everybody's just hearing that that's where it's going to come from. Right. I guarantee you the NFL would have put that out there. They said that they wanted us to divest from some of these other places that everybody is for. You know what I mean? To be able to and make the NFL look like they were so, you know, trying to work with them.
So basically,
if somebody came in here, and they said, okay, Roland, I'm a match. A gift. Oh, how much your panelists give? Okay, and if it's five of us, so we say, okay, fine, we gonna give $50,000, and I say I'm gonna give 25 of that $50,000, and then y'all make up the rest. An outside person said, no, Roland, you can't give 25, you can only give 75, the rest gotta come from everybody else, which is ridiculous, because what Eric said is that that essentially. The amount of money, they would have to get $5,000 from nearly every player on every NFL team to match the amount the league was given. Why should you care if one player gives 50 or 75 or 100 or a million? Why?
So they can say, look, we tried and they didn't do their part.
Yeah.
They put an offer on the
they're
table.
They're playing chess, not checkers. So they're trying to say.
You're creating the rules.
Right.
You're controlling the narrative.
Yeah.
You're controlling everything. And yes, if it didn't work, they turned their backs on $80 million.
Right.
I thought it was supposed to be $100 million. Last year.
Well,
it was supposed to be $100 million. Mm-hmm. And even then, I looked at it as like, you know, when you broke it down, I think it came out like $2 million a team. And
over 5 years.
It was over 5 years. Right. So it came out like $2 million a team. And these teams make more than that on Sunday concessions.
Right.
So it was nothing.
It was all about. Can y'all just shut the hell up?
It was.
Stop
it was,
protesting.
It was.
And that's what the whole deal is.
Absolutely.
Eton, final comment.
And another part that really bothered Eric Reid was there was no mention of Kaepernick not being blackballed. And that they wanted that to be something that was in there. So they're like, wait, so Kaepernick's still going to be blackballed and we're still going to go
actually,
along?
Actually, white-balled.
White-balled, I'm sorry. and we're still going to go along and that's just going to be okay? And he felt almost that they just kind of pushed him to the side.
Yes.
Now, that's not to say that the Players Coalition hasn't done a lot of great things. Mm-hmm. They've been here in D.C. lobbying for laws to be changed. They do a lot of criminal justice reform. They do a lot of good things. So I don't want to not say that. But as far as Eric Reid is concerned, the way that it went about, I can understand why he's upset.
And I also know some people who are very upset that there are three white women who are running the Players Coalition.
I'm just letting you know.
That's what, and I saw it personally when I was on the panel with them at the Super Bowl in Houston. Mm-hmm.